I found that to be very interesting in case that you're not aware of it. The person being interviewed was Keith Urban, who is a popular artist in the category of country music, I guess, and that you would place him. But very interesting words as he communicated with his children about what took place last Sunday night. And he referred to the country music industry as family. You know, that this was a terrible event that happened, but because we're family, it has a personal impact. And then he went on to speak of his church and kind of equate it to the church. I may not know everybody, but we're family. I thought that was interesting. Let me tell you, this world doesn't need a country music family. This world needs a God family. Amen? This world needs a God family. And I wanted you to see that because I think it's important to know, and I'm going to share with you today, I'm going to be teaching on growing our church family and responding to the world. Okay? And so I did appreciate and I love the words that he was saying, but I equated it to just that. As he's saying, you know, we're all part of a family in the country music industry. We're all part of God's family. And that's the family that's going to make a difference in this world. There's a story for you. There was a father who was in a conversation with his daughter. Now, this dad didn't exactly look like George Clooney or Brad Pitt. Those are like really like hot-looking guys, right, ladies? You would say, you know, you would call those guys, you know, especially for us older people or for the younger ladies. I don't know who you think is hot, like Adam Levine, you know, that guy. Nick Jonas, is he still hot? Girls, or anybody from One Direction? I don't know anybody from One Direction, but you know. So anyway, the dad didn't look like any of those, okay? Any of those guys. But the little girl was sitting on her dad's lap, and she was gazing at him intently, looking intently at him into his eyes and his face, and looking for several minutes. And finally, she says to her dad, "Daddy, did God make you?" And the dad responds and says, "He sure did." And the girl says, the daughter says, "And did he make me too?" And she asked him, and the dad says, "Yes, he did. Why are you asking?" And the daughter says to her dad, "Because it seems to me he's doing much better work lately." He's doing much better. Aren't kids great? They're so honest, right? They're so honest. Can't you just see a little five-year-old girl saying that? I don't know if any of you remember, perhaps you remember the reality TV show, the Duggar family? Anyone remember that? A guy by the name of Jim Duggar and his wife Michelle, they're from Springfield, Arkansas. They now have 19 children. Oh my goodness, that does something to me just thinking about it. It's not good. 19 children. Now, see, they've definitely spent some time growing their family, right? You know? But Jim Duggar said once, he says, "We searched the scripture and we found that God says the following." He says in Psalms 127, 3 through 5, is that children are a heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. As arrows are in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. Happy is the man that has his quiver full of them. Well, they apparently took that scripture to heart. You know, and live their life. He went on in this interview to say that Dr. Edward Wheat had counseled them before they were married and encouraged them not to have a television. We were talking about, remember, growing our family and what that looks like. Not to have a television in their first year of marriage. And so he said that they took their advice, and so the first year they didn't. And then finally they succumbed to the temptation and they hooked up cable. And they realized quickly the difference in their communication as a family and how it dropped off. And so after just a month of having television and cable, they pulled it out of their home and thought later that it was one of the best decisions they ever made, because their children grew up not watching broadcast television. And so I'm not saying that's right, wrong, or indifferent. I'm just saying that's how they chose as a method to grow their family. All right? And so, and it worked for them. And so their thought process was that it was a great protection for their family and their children, and it was a time saver. And he went on to say that they occasionally would watch an educational video or a Christian movie, but only on a limited basis. They did have computers in their home, but even those weren't allowed to devour their time. And the thought was is that as parents, we're responsible for every influence that we allow into our children's lives. Would you agree with that? We're responsible. So what is the proper way to grow a family? That's how they grew their family. Well, one thing's for sure that I've found over the years, it's a lot easier to give birth to a family than it is to raise a family, right? Sometimes I think it's easier just to give birth than it is to actually go through the journey and raising a family, raising children. Because raising children today, in today's world, it's getting tougher and tougher. Right? It's getting more difficult. I think gone are the days where, you know, when I was a kid and the things I was going through, what we heard from adults was, well, it's no different than when I was a child. It was no different than when I grew up. So they're kind of going through the same things. Well, I think we live in a world today where it is different. It is different. And they face different temptations and with social media and technology and everything that, and all the temptations that our kids carry around in their purse, in their pockets, is amazing of what they have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. The church family and the church is described in Scripture as a family. The description of the church is as a family. So how do we grow our church family? Because both giving birth and the raising up of are hard to do. Wouldn't you agree? I'll give you an illustration. There's several churches that my wife and I have had the honor and the joy to attend at one point in time in our life and our ministry, and all of these, but Willow Creek Community Church in South Barrington, Illinois, Southeast Christian Church in Louisville, Kentucky, and Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia, are all considered a few of the largest non-denominational Christian churches in the United States. They all started over 45 years ago with just a handful of people attending. Just a handful, sometimes less than 25 people. And so they now, all of those churches average well over 20,000 people each weekend in multiple services. That's amazing. Can you imagine 20,000 people over that in some cases in weekend services? It's not easy to grow a church like that, because if it were, there'd be a lot more of them, right? And so those churches grew because they were for whatever reason, that place and time in this world, they were ordained by God, and they were anointed by God. So large or small, the church belongs to the Lord. And He wants His church family to grow, but not necessarily in attendance. And we get hung up on that. We get hung up on numbers. We get hung up on attendance and buildings and the amount of money that we raise. But that's not His desire for our lives. His desire for our lives is to be changed, to be a changed people, to be a transformed church, to be a transformed family that can speak into the world louder than the country music family. I'm going to give you a sidebar here. I'm going to admit something to you, okay? Some of you may say, "Oh man, I wish he wouldn't have told me that about himself." But I like country music. You know, I like Keith Urban. I love his music. He's very gifted. But the world needs the church family to speak louder than the country music family. And until we do, we're not going to see change. You see, his desire is not simply for us to grow in attendance and buildings and cash and the amount of money we raise, but his desire is for lives and families and churches to be transformed and then to be discipled and for us to become more like him, for us to become to begin loving like him, for us to begin caring like him, and for us to begin serving like him. You know, in Acts chapter 2, it talks about growing our church family and how numbers were added to their fellowship. People were saved. And so I'm convinced that we get hung up on that. We think in terms of church growth. We always want to revert back to Acts chapter 2. 42 through 47, and say that that's a church growth kind of a plan, because he was adding to their numbers. He was adding to the number of people who were saved. I like to think that's talking about salvation. That's talking about transformation. It's not talking about a church building. You see, in the scripture from the life of Christ, we get something of an idea of growing a church family with three simple things, the three words I want to talk to you about today. And those words are this: method, motivation, and means. And those are three words. I want you to jot those down. Method, motivation, and means. The method of growing our family and then responding to this world is through preaching and teaching. What does that look like? Well, in Matthew chapter 9, beginning with verse 35, Matthew chapter 9, beginning with verse 35, is the passage that I'm going to be sharing from today. And I'm going to read to you out of the NIV, beginning with verse 35, if you want to follow along. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. That's pretty descriptive of our world, wouldn't you say? When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to the disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. So the method that Jesus is talking about is preaching and teaching. That was the method to attain the purpose. And there's always a method to a purpose. If you have a purpose in life, there is a method for you to attain that purpose and to get to that point. When Benjamin Franklin was just 27 years old, he decided he would take control of his own life. And he selected 12 virtues that he wanted to acquire, and so he kept a daily chart of his progress in the development of each one. And whenever he missed the mark, he would put a black dot beside that virtue. His goal was to ultimately have no dots on the chart. That was the method that contributed to his success as an inventor, as a publisher, and as a statement. That was Benjamin Franklin's method to attain his purpose in life. You see, everyone has a method for accomplishing their purpose. You can't just have a purpose and no method to see it through. You understand what I'm saying? Whether your purpose is family, whether it's a career, whether it's finances, whether it's a hobby such as fishing and hunting or golfing, painting, cleaning. Well, that's one. Who has a purpose of cleaning? I don't know why, but not too many people would enjoy that purpose in life, right? Or shopping or gardening. But you understand, right? But what about growing our church family? What's our method? What's if that's our purpose, what's our method in responding to this world? What's our method? Dwight Moody was often criticized for his evangelistic methods that he had throughout his ministry and life. And he would often reply when questioned about it. He says, "I like my way of doing it better than your way of not doing it." That's good, isn't it? You see, that, my friends, is often our problem, is that we have no way of doing it. We have no method. We verbalize and we speak and about our purpose and what our purpose is, but we have no method to get there and to live it out. Teaching, preaching, and healing, and serving, those were the methods that Jesus used to reach people and to grow the church family. So what's our method today? I've seen healing take place. I've seen physical healing take place. Anyone has seen someone physically healed in your lifetime? That's a wonderful thing. But would you agree, it doesn't seem as prevalent today. We don't see it as often. And maybe it's because that we get hung up on that we're visual and we think that that's the only healing that can take place, and we have to see that, but we have no method to get there, so we can't live out that purpose. So we get hung up on always looking for physical healing, and we miss opportunities for spiritual healing. And we miss opportunities for relational healing. And we miss opportunities for emotional healing. We miss opportunities for financial healing. But just so you know, God still heals people physically. And I believe that with all my heart, and I've seen that, and I've witnessed that, as many of you have. There's a lot of preaching and teaching that goes on inside the church. Wouldn't you agree? Not just here on Sunday mornings, but you know, if you come here on Wednesday evenings, you'll see a lot of teaching that's happening, both with adults and with children and with our teenagers. If you remember, Jesus did most of his teaching outside of the church. He did most of his teaching on his journey from town to town as he journeyed. And he served, and he taught, and he healed, and he loved, and he cared. But that's a little different in today's world. If we preach and teach outside of the building, outside of the physical church, we live in a world where it has to be a little bit lower key maybe today, right? Because the days of standing on the street corner and teaching the gospel are probably gone. Because if you did it, you never know. You could be sued in the world we live in, or you could be attacked, or you could end up in jail. You just don't know in today's world. So where's that leave us? You see, our method for preaching and teaching outside of the church today, I think, is a beautiful description. In 1 Peter 3:15, it says, But in your hearts set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this for gentleness. Do this with gentleness and respect. Now, I want you to make note of that passage of Scripture, 1 Peter 3:15. And I'm going to share that with you again. But in your heart, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone. I like the clarity of that. Always be prepared to answer to everyone. Not just be prepared sometimes for a few people, but always to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. Why does the world need the church family to speak louder than the country music family? Because of this, my friends. Because we have to speak about the hope that we have with gentleness and respect. Always be prepared. But see, people want to know the reason for the hope that you have, especially when they have just went through a crisis in their life, especially when they've lost their hope because of what happened last Sunday night, especially if they've lost their hope due to losing everything that they own through a hurricane. They need to know about your hope in Christ Jesus. So how about telling your story? And so you may be saying, well, Pastor Brad, how do I do it? How should I be prepared to answer to everyone? I can't do that. That's too difficult. And give them the reason for the hope. Listen, we don't need to overcomplicate this. You know where you were when Christ found you, right? Over here. Can everybody remember that? Do you remember the day? Do you remember where you were when Jesus came to reside in your heart and your life and you came in relationship with Him? Do you remember where you were? Look where you are now. Look where you are now. And you know what this journey is? When you started from here and He brought you over here, that's the hope. That's the hope that you have. He saved you from over there. And He brought you to here. So how about just telling your story? You see, we all have a story from where we started to where we are. And it's the idea that we have a testimony or a word for Christ, and the church has to be ready for this opportunity. The church has to be ready to give this hope to the world. Remember when you first gave your life to Christ, and you remember being over there? Do you remember the excitement and the passion and the energy that and the desire to tell everyone? Can you remember that? That when you came into this relationship with God, you wanted to tell everybody what He had done in your life, right? What He had brought you from. What you left behind, what you were leaving behind, and where you were going. We had this purpose, we had this passion, and we had this excitement, we had this energy. Oh, if we could just live our lives like that daily. That could be your method. So where do you preach and teach now? Or do you? And if so, what do you say? When do you say it? How often do you say it? You see, it really doesn't make a difference where, when, or how, as long as it gets done. You see, we all need to be quick to point people to Christ. Sometimes we're quicker to anger than we are quicker to pointing people to Christ. We all need to be quick to point people to Christ, to the church, and to truth. Why the church? Because the church is God's bride. The church is the family of God that needs to speak loudly into the world. And see, what I've discovered in all my years of ministry is that they're hurting people all around us. Would you agree with that? They're hurting people all around us. They're hurting people at work, at our works, at our schools, in our neighborhoods, where we shop, where we dine, where we get medical care, at food pantries, at free stores, at recovery groups, in cafes, in restaurants. You get the point. There are hurting people everywhere, and we need to point them to Christ as the Savior of the world. It is possible that the least effective method to preach and teach is from behind the pulpit in a physical location of what we call the church. And the most effective method is outside the walls of the traditional church. By you simply sharing where you were and where you are and the hope in between. Matthew chapter 10, verse 7, it says, as you go, preach this message. The kingdom of heaven is near. In Matthew 28, verse 9, it says, therefore go. So 10:7 says, as you go, preach this message. Matthew 28 says, therefore go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. So I think Jesus might be saying to us today, church, is as you go to your job, as you go to work, as you go to school, as you go shopping, as you go to the coffee shop or the local diner, as you take your kids to the soccer fields, the football fields, the baseball fields, or wherever you may go, preach and teach, tell your story, witness, point people to Christ. First, point people to the church and don't ever waste an opportunity. The second one is this, motivation. We have a method, we have a motivation. Motivation equals compassion. Method was preaching and teaching, motivation equals compassion. There were two psychiatrists who occupied offices in the same building. One was 40 years old and the other was 70 years old. And they rode the elevator together at the end of a terribly bad day. The younger man was completely exhausted after seeing all his patients all day long, one right after another. The older man looked fresh as a daisy, and the younger doctor looked to the older man and said, I don't understand how you can listen to hurting people all day long and still look so great at the end of the day. I get that sometimes, do you? You still look so great at the end of the day? The older psychiatrist says, I don't know, who listens anyway? Who listens? Apparently, he only pretended to listen to people, which may be our problem sometimes, you think? That we only pretend to listen to people? We only pretend to hear people because when they talk about the pain and the hurt in their life, and we're not always so quick to listen or to sympathize when they're disclosing that hurt. But compassion is what motivated Jesus. Compassion is the essence of His gospel. Someone once said, charity is more common than compassion. Charity is tax deductible. Compassion is time consuming. Remember 9:36, Matthew 9:36, it says, when He saw the crowds, He had what? Compassion. He had compassion on them because they were harassed, because they were helpless, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. I read a story once of a pastor who was in an office supply store, a Kinko's, and he was getting some copies done of his Sunday morning bulletin. He ran into a lady. There was no one else in the store. He ran into a lady who began to unload on him. And that happens sometimes, right? That for all of us. And she began to tell him about her father, who was very, very ill with cancer, and she lived in Texas, and she was in this other state, this other town, and she was there to spend time with him. And because she left she wanted to go spend the last days with her father, she lost her job. She was fired. So she lost her job. And she came to spend time with her father, and she went on to say that she just wanted to come and be with him. He's the only father that she had. And the pastor felt bad for her as he listened to this story and told her that he was sorry. But he didn't ask. He didn't go beyond that. He didn't ask if he could do anything. So he was listening on one hand, but on the other hand, maybe he wasn't really listening, because he didn't go on. He didn't say, "Can I go see him? Can I go pray with him?" He was sorry. Listen, there are hurting people that need for someone to demonstrate compassion. That pastor later shared a story with some people that he remembered that encounter that he had afterwards, but it was too late. He felt like he had missed an opportunity. That he missed an opportunity to demonstrate compassion. These are always opportunities that God orchestrates for us to speak into the life of the world and to speak into the life of someone else. The last one, and we're going to close with this, is means. So, means equals disciples. Method, preaching and teaching. Means equals disciples. Matthew 9:37-38 says, then He said to the disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into His field. Sometimes that's all it takes, right? Is word of mouth. It's the best form. You've all heard of different types of advertising in the secular world, right? Or in the business world. There's different types of advertising. People advertise on television. They advertise on radio. They advertise with banners. And they advertise with Super Bowl ads, with everything you could think of. But sometimes it's just the word of mouth about what God has done in your life. You see, that applies to the church. If we truly believe in God the Father, if we truly believe in Jesus Christ, if we truly believe in the Holy Spirit, and that He's given us new life, He's transformed us, He's changed us, if we believe in the crucifixion, if we believe that He conquered death for us, and if we believe in the resurrection and that He's coming back for us, then people are more inclined to listen when we speak to Him, if we believe that. Are you talking to anyone about Christ? Are you talking to anyone about the church? You see, we are the means by which the church must grow, and we are the means by which the family that make up the church is transformed by the power of Christ. You see, if we don't build bridges, and if we don't share the word, if we don't pray, if we don't love, if we don't serve, then it doesn't get done. It just doesn't get done. And then the church doesn't grow. The church isn't changed. The church isn't transformed. And the church loses an opportunity to speak louder than the world. God uses people. He uses His people to grow His kingdom, to grow His people, and to grow His church. He said to the disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of a harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest field." Jesus gave the disciples the task of praying for more workers. That's what that's talking about. He gave them the task or the assignment to pray for more workers. Have you ever tried that? Have you ever prayed, "Lord, would you send more workers to Willard Nazarene?" It's okay to pray that. Would you raise them up then in the Father? What would happen if we tried that together? We need workers, right? We can always use more people. Because the harvest is large. Sometimes the workers are few. The world needs us to need more workers. How about if we pray? Let's pray that right now. Can we pray that right now? Do you believe that? Do you believe we can approach the throne over anything, any matter? Let's pray that right now. Father, we claim that passage of Scripture. And then He said to His disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into His harvest field." So we ask You that, Father, and we claim that in Your name, but we ask You that for here, specifically, for Willard Church of the Nazarene. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And so we ask that You would bring more workers, You would bring more people with a desire and a passion for their life to be changed and for their life to be transformed, but make the church prevalent in their life. Give us the courage as a church, as a family, to speak louder than the world is speaking. Continue to give us that understanding that we know that the world needs the church family, the family of God, more than it needs the country music family or the entertainment family or any of that. We ask You that in Your name. We give You praise. Amen. Listen, growth is inevitable. Growth is inevitable if the body is healthy. Our children bearing a serious illness or disease will naturally grow into healthy adults, right? And so will the church. The Lord's people will grow and so will His church, but only if it is healthy and doesn't become ill or catch a life-threatening disease. And you may be saying, Pastor Brad, what are you talking about? A church can't catch a disease? Yes, it can, because it's made up of people, right? I'm talking about the disease of dissension, the disease of division, the disease of arguing and fighting and backbiting and unwholesome talk, like Paul said. But praise God, He's bigger than any of those things, isn't He? And He provides us opportunities of growth as people and as a church, being transformed into His likeness, being transformed into His image, becoming more like Him every day. So my prayer for us is that God would continue to guide and direct us to do whatever. I love that word, to do whatever. Because we don't always like whatever. Whatever His will may be, so that we can help His people and His church grow in Christ. And the result will be that we will see His family grow, and we will see His family respond to a broken world. Father, we pray this morning that prayer as Your people. We pray those words. May You, Father, continue to guide and direct us to do whatever. Would you repeat that with me? Can we pray that prayer together? Father, would You continue to guide and direct us to do whatever Your will may be. Say it with me again. Father God, continue to guide and direct us to do whatever Your will may be, so that we can help Your people and Your church grow in Christ. And the result will be we will see Your family grow and respond to this world. In Your name, amen. Amen. Thank You very much for Your generosity, for Your kindness. But more than any of the cards and the gifts, thank You for the care and the concern and the love and the prayer. We cherish that. We cherish that. So may God be with you today. May you go in grace and peace. We love you. We pray for you. Enjoy the sunshine, would you? You are dismissed.